very much, Amy. I'm just going to read some of the things that I've written during the course of listening this morning. I was sad that Juliet and I didn't get to play with the pleasure and the lekker. And I wondered if this would inhibit the creativity of our responses to the presentations this morning, but maybe we can take some away with us and play with it, ruminating further on when we think about how to take these ideas further strategically, which I think is what we need to do in the institution. And what I've written is really a stream of consciousness in response to the speakers, so it might be a little bit repetitive and not ordered or polished. Think back to Shirley and her emphasis on time, which Miriam has come back to, and we heard about in the political science student interview. I think that regulated timetables and schedules would really have to be relooked if we want to achieve what Tyrone Pretorius has spoken about in the T-shaped graduate, which looks really at inter- and transdisciplinarity in addition to disciplines and modules and professional degrees and councils. And looking at solving complex problems both in depth and breadth, I think that this will not be achieved without substantial change in the institution. Shirley also spoke about working, and I'm pleased that in the course of the day we incorporated both paid and unpaid work, because we heard about the work of caring, which is often gendered, as people have pointed out. And I think we our responsibility is allocated, which does also affect learning. We need to imagine how best to accommodate students and lecturers, because we all engage in these practices and negotiate time and spaces. Shirley asked the crucial question about what conditions need to change so that working students could be able to study. And if we think now that every student is a working student, it doesn't help to piecemeal change things in the institution. We need to really think about whole institutional change. If you read Shirley's report, it talks about pace, place, and mode being important in flexibility. Pedagogical practices and I would say participatory parity are also important concepts to think about. In terms of lifelong learners, I think we do need to know more about our students. We have done certain student surveys and that sort of thing, but we need more information, and I think every teacher at this institution needs to know more about the realities and the circumstances that students are living with. And of course, Shirley has managed to bring out very interesting people as part of this project. Tara Fenwick and Richard Edwards gave wonderful talks about the materiality of learning and flexible provision. And Anne Edwards and her relationality and talks about resourceful leadership, I think, are very important. And her processes of thinking about what matters. I think that, you know, the kind of leadership we have, as Kurbus also indicated, is critical in the way in which we go forward in this institution. Shirley spoke about strong up and top down and bottom up approaches and changing these. And we've also worked with middle out as well as that, because I think it is also important to work with people like heads of departments and people who are in charge of whole programs rather than just working individually. We also need to see what we can use that's already available in our environments, to look around, for example, for in existing massive open online courses and other open educational resources, how to incorporate and use these in the curriculum instead of reinventing the wheel time and again. People are talking about pre-university study of online courses in ways of preparing people to come. And also in Shirley's report, she refers to universal design. I am really convinced that this is a good way to go, universal design for learning, because it's looking at what resources we need and how we can accommodate difference with learners and respond to difference as a positive thing rather than as an othering or negative thing. What wasn't flagged so much, but what I think is very important, is collaborative work across higher education institutions and nationally. We have, for example, been working on a postgraduate diploma in teaching and learning in higher education across institutions in the Western Cape, and we've learnt a lot from that. We're also working nationally with 10 different institutions in sharing our resources in developing a postgraduate diploma. Miriam, I liked her emphasis on justice and a critical orientation towards education, how to renew democratic practices. And, you know, if we looked at something simple like participatory parity, it is something that we have to bear in mind and something very, very difficult to achieve. So we have students coming in very differently placed. How do we get those students to be leaving with the graduate attributes that we've put out in this institution? How do we engage in socially just pedagogies? And I think we really do need to acknowledge the inequalities in education as a whole in this country, in South Africa, and also in higher education, and how this impacts on us at UWC. I think some of the things we battle with are not institutional, they are national and even international. So as long as we keep beating ourselves up about our individual practices, rather than seeing the relationality of these, I don't think we're going to be getting very far. How am I doing for time? I think I'm going to cut some of what I was going to say. And I've been asked to develop a green paper on the 21st century learner for our new management. And I think, you know, one can't imagine the 21st century learner in isolation without being very conscious and mindful of who our learners at UWC are, what their needs are and what their current circumstances are. We need to keep looking at the past and sentiments of people like Jake Scaville, and bear in mind what Tyron Pretorius now has in his idea of the T-shaped graduate attribute. So we need to start looking at people at this institution who've engaged in inter and transdisciplinary classrooms, people like, for example, Richard Knight, who has arts, law, and natural science students in his undergraduate classroom who are all dialoguing and working on issues of biodiversity, bringing their disciplinary strengths together to consider complex problems. We've heard of good examples this morning as well from all the disciplines that have presented here. And I think the need for administrators to be involved in these sorts of processes has also come to our attention this morning and in our questionnaire to students about their needs. So we have to include these sorts of people in our conceptions of good education and flexible learning. And we need to look not only at modes of delivery, but what sort of learning activities and in what places. We don't have conducive spaces, many flexible spaces
We do here in these buildings, but not all buildings are like that. My experience of working with flexible learning has been with these postgraduate diplomas and working with higher educators who are themselves very put upon and who have little time on their hands for additional tasks. And we've been thinking about flexibility in relation to their needs. So we have, for example, 20 higher educators from Venda on our course, and we've had to think about ways in which to make the course flexible for them. There they don't often have good internet access, so we've had to rely on things like WhatsApp groups in order to communicate with people, because I think interactions have to be taken into account. And how we take all these ideas forward in our institution is, as I said, going to be dependent on how receptive our new leadership is in making things happen, in actually putting resources behind our flexible intentions, and the political will to actually engage in embedding graduate attributes in the curriculum process. And it will mean huge shifts, actually, in academic planning, in learning spaces, paying attention to the materiality of students' and lecturers' lives and to the curriculum, and in looking for examples in current programs and practices that are engaging in flexible provision, like those we've heard about, and then using these principles to inform our policy and practices with the provision of resources. Thanks.
Okay.
Was it off?
Thank you to Prof. Walters. I don't have much time. This morning, Prof. Walters highlighted the paradoxes in the university context, and I've realized, Vivienne and I discussed earlier, this collaborative project should not be addressed as a silo intervention. We've seen it. It's not separated from the mainstream teaching and learning activities. And like Prof. Corbis said earlier, the university is going to change. So we are looking at strategic papers now around university in the digital age and the 21st century student. So I'm just going to highlight some of our speakers. I think I should highlight what they said in terms in alignment to the critical discourses from national and institutional policies. That's why we have the SACWA group here as well. So in terms of the notion of successful integration of ICTs, we can't do this without the support for academics and students. There's no way we can't think about the design of these online environments and how to enhance the support for these teaching and learning practices. So there's a lot of debate now in higher education, what's going to happen to our academic identities. We also had students, distant students from Tata and those areas. And answering the phone, speaking to people from rural areas, not only via online processes, is this in interference with your academic identity, or are you seeing this as part of your work? These are debates that's happening in higher education. Shirley highlighted the model process, people, and technology. It's an old model, but still we see the importance of the technology and the people. Uta very clearly highlighted what is being demanded us from the National Development Plan, the provision of learner support materials. We're not going to get away from that. You can't just put things online or deliver them in any other way. But just-in-time training material, we're going to have to develop this. And are you only relying on a support team to develop this, or are you going to get engaged in developing those materials? You cannot always pass the buck to somebody else. And blended learning approaches, thinking about integrated assessments. Uta said there's no exams. But it doesn't mean there's no exams. She didn't think about her integrated assessment. And she highlighted dedicated education expertise. Then there's the discourse around maintenance of rigorous quality assurance. I can see how her work is aligned to the white paper for post-school training. You do need those, she called them superb admin and logistics. They are part of our teaching and learning now. They become teaching assistants. They're not just your administrator. They're taking on these online environments. They are superb assistants. And then the importance of continuous exploration of emerging technologies. You never know it all. It came across. Things will always emerge, not just for mere access, but she mentioned for the retention of social interaction. And that is what came across strongly. Now we are all involved here because there's an ongoing debate about distance education. Remember in the past it was easy to say it's UNISA and it's us. No more. We have to continuously think about the significant investment in program design and the development of material. This is from the Council of Higher Education. That's why we're here today. And this came through in Sally's presentation, negotiating time and cost. But it wasn't just the cost, money, investment in human capacity and time. And again, Sally, how has that changed your academic identity? Some of the things people spoke about in the past is mundane, and an administrator will do that. Mm-hmm. No, it's becoming part of your work. And she spoke about enabling structures and disabling structures. And most of all, digital inclusion. Are we doing this to exclude people? Are we doing this for digital inclusion? Those debates should continue. And again, there's a debate on the education accountability chain. The SACWA people will know that. It's coming across in the policies now. We are part of that discussions. So these projects that we are involved in here, are we doing it just for ourselves, or are we doing it, as the government is asking us, to develop a cadre of people for the next generation? I hope that's why we are all here. But it's not easy. Cheryl is surfing the tsunami. Even in her discipline, she's preparing people for the future. But they're not only supposed to think of their futures, but of the entire socioeconomic developments in our country. And that concept of balance is so important. And then for Cheryl and for everybody else here, the importance of reflection. That is why Shirley has set up this group here. We have to reflect. And whether we like it or not, remember we didn't want to speak about access, success, and throughput. And we're speaking about collegial versus managerial. Those debates are blurring. It's part of our discussions, whether we like it or not. And that is why Cheryl spoke about systemic approaches in the future. She didn't just mention a system or an individual, but rather we need to think about this in a systemic way. And when we develop this cadre of people, I hope that we're not, as Heidi says, separating the research from the teaching. It's difficult, but we can do it together. There's no way we can separate it. But it's tough for us, but we need to think of how to be good teachers as well as researchers. Sorry, that was Miriam. Heidi brought us to, she spoke to us about terms on quality, redress, access, and progression. And Heidi, you can see it's easy in theory, in document, but here when you are in live projects, it's not leisure time. You know, we're dealing with some critical issues and how to articulate it on the ground. We need to continue with those debates. And then lifelong learning. It's not as easy as said as continuous professional development and support. But as you heard from all the speakers, it is embedded in the discourse around expansion and improvement in higher education. We're not going to be removed from those debates. And I have not mentioned seat, and I have not mentioned a specific structure, because we are not doing this on our own. This is everybody's business. You cannot put something online and think, give it over to somebody else. This is our business. And that is why Vivian so rightfully said that our leaders are going to have to invest from the top. They need to assist us. And that is why we have the dean here and the ex-dean. It's their business too. To have them here and actually get up to present shows that it's not just our business. There we have our dean, Kobus Visser. He's actually hands-on, getting dirty within a flexible project. Yeah. I can go on and on, but thank you. It's our business.